be seated. That overcomes the world. Hallelujah. Faith is the victory. Here comes the dreamer. Here comes the dreamer. This weekend we celebrate the birthday of the great civil rights leader and preacher, Martin Luther King Jr. We're glad that they have made and recognized his birthday as a public holiday because he has done such great work. Please turn with me to Genesis chapter 37. Genesis chapter 37. Genesis chapter 37, and we'll be reading from verse 1 through verse 11 and verses 19 and 20. Genesis 37, verses 1 through 11 and verses 19 and 20. When you're there, say amen.
Amen.
That is good. And Jacob dwelt in the land wherein his father was a stranger, in the land of Canaan. These are the generations of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brethren. And the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and with the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought unto his father their evil report. Now Israel, or Jacob, loved Joseph more than all his children, because he was the son of his old age. And he made him a coat of many colors. And when his brethren saw that their father loved him more than all his brethren, they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him. And Joseph dreamed a dream, and he told it his brethren, and they hated him yet the more. And he said unto them, Hear, I pray you, this dream which I have dreamed. For behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and lo, my sheaf arose and also stood upright, and behold, your sheaves stood round about and made obeisance to my sheep. And his brethren said to him, Shalt thou indeed reign over us? Or shalt thou indeed have dominion over us? And they hated him yet the more for his dreams and for his words. And he dreamed yet another dream and told it his brethren and said, Behold, I have dreamed a dream more. And behold, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars made obeisance to me. And he told it to his father and to his brethren. And his father rebuked him and said unto him, What is this dream that thou hast dreamed? Shall I and thy mother and thy brethren indeed come to bow down ourselves to thee unto the earth? And his brethren envied him, but his father observed the saying. Verse 19. And they said one to another, Behold, this dreamer cometh. Come now therefore, and let us slay him, and cast him into the pit. And we will say, Some evil beast hath devoured him, and we shall see what will become of his dreams. And I borrowed the title today, Behold, this dreamer cometh. Here comes that dreamer. Let us pray. God, we thank you for your everlasting love. We thank you for the gift of your word that you have given unto us. And we pray now, Lord, as we would listen to no other voice but your voice, that you would speak your own self through your servant, that you would hide me behind the cross, that your Holy Spirit's presence will be felt, and that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart will be acceptable unto thee, my strength and my redeemer. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. It has been said that a man is never old until regrets take the place of his dream. Martin Luther King Jr. rallied the civil rights movement behind one clarion call: I have a dream. We use the word dream in a variety of ways. And when we think of dreams, we usually think of dreams in the night. But dreams are also visions, goals, and aspirations. Those things you sit around and you sit upright when something hits you and you say, oh, I should accomplish that, or I should accomplish this. That becomes a dream or a vision. What is your dream this morning? What do you envision for your life? What do you hope for or long for? What are your goals and aspirations? Our dreams determine our qualities of life. Proverbs 23, verse 7 says, as a man thinketh, so is he. As he thinketh, so is he. As he thinks in his heart, so is he. Without a dream for our lives, we drift aimlessly through life, reacting to one circumstance after another. Without a dream, we lack the master plan by which we build our lives. Proverbs 29, verse 18 reminds us, where there is no vision, the people perish. On the other hand, when we possess a dream for our lives, inspired by God, then we live with a plan. I'm not talking this morning about grandiose delusions, because many people are grandiose delusionaries. They have great aspiration that has nothing to do with God or his plans. They are going to achieve great things on their own. I'm talking about when you set a plan within the will of God and with him as your guide. When we set those dreams, when they are inspired by God, we live with that plan. Each day, every decision fits into a larger plan as our dreams become reality. God gives dreams and visions for life. Joel 2:28 says, "And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, your young men shall see vision." Verse 29 says, "And also upon the servants and upon the handmaids in those days will I pour out my spirit." Hosea chapter 12 verse 10 says, "I have also spoken by the prophets, and I have multiplied visions and used similitudes by the ministry of the prophets." Acts chapter 26 verse 19 says, "Whereupon, O King Agrippa," Paul is speaking in the courts, "I was not disobedient unto the heavenly vision." One of the best loved personalities in the Bible is Joseph. As children, we remember hearing about his beautiful coat of many colors. We know him as a man with a dream from God that shaped his destiny. Here's a synopsis of what happened. He was 17 years old and the favorite son of Jacob, the washbelly, at that time. Jacob had 12 sons. He brought a bad report about his brothers to his father. He had two dreams during the night. In dream number one, he saw sheaves of grain. His sheaf rose up, and his brother's sheaves bowed down to his. In dream number two, his parents were included. The sun and the moon and the 11 stars were bowing down to him. When he shared his dreams with his family, they resented him, and his father rebuked him. Eventually, his other brothers, excluding Benjamin, the youngest, sold Joseph into slavery to a wandering band of Ishmaelites who took him to Egypt and sold him to Potiphar. But in Egypt, Joseph's dream became a reality. Amen. Note that Joseph dreamed when he was young. Verse 2 says, "These are the generation of Jacob, Joseph being 17 years old." Joseph was a young boy. And in here we see the importance of youth. Ecclesiastes verse 12, chapter 12 verse 1 says, "Remember now thy creator in the days of thy youth, while the evil days come not, nor the years draw nigh, when thou shalt say, I have no pleasure in them." 1 Timothy chapter 4 verse 12 says, "Let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers in the word, in conversation, in charity, in spirit, in faith, in purity." Most people accept Christ as their Savior before they reach age 18. And most people who accept the call of God to full-time ministry do so before they are 21. These people dreamed while young. Pascal wrote a book. He wrote a great work at the age of 16. He died at the young age of 37. John Calvin joined the Reformation at age 21. And at age 27, he wrote the Institutes of the Christian Religion. Isaac Newton was 24 when he formulated the law of gravity and made some of his greatest discoveries before he was 25. Charles Spurgeon, one of my favorite preachers, was a powerful preacher in his early 20s. And by 25, he pastored the largest church in London. And we could go on and on and talk about those who've had great dreams while they were young. Dreams are also for those who are older. Joel 2:28 states that your old men will dream dreams. One man wrote, he says, I get up each morning, dust off my wits, pick up my paper and read the obits. If my name is missing, I know I'm not dead. So I eat a good breakfast and go back to bed. Moses was 80 when God called him to deliver Israel. Michelangelo was writing poetry and designing buildings up to the time of his death at 90. He painted the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel on his back on a scaffold at nearly 90 years of age. John Wesley, another great preacher, one whom I admire a lot, preached for 40 years, produced 400 books, knew 10 languages. At 86, he complained he was able to preach no more than twice a day. Joseph dreamt while he was young. Young people, you can have dreams. You can dream dreams. And you can pursue them. The thing about dreams is that we can forget them as fast as they come.
Yes.
But if we hold on to our dreams and we commit them to God, the Lord says, acknowledge me in all your ways, and I will direct thy path. Once you acknowledge God, He will direct your path.
Yes.
You're never too old to dream. Some of us have grown old with unfulfilled dreams. And the reason they are unfulfilled is that we did not commit them to the Lord. They were brilliant ideas, but we must commit them to the Lord. I tell you something. If you can promise God that at the end of everything, you will give Him all the glory.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Lord, I'm going to be in the background. I'm only the producer. I'm only the instrument that you use. I give you all the glory. Amen. God will materialize your dream.
Amen.
The reason all these people in Hollywood crash is because God is not in their dream. God must be in the dream, or you're going to lose the battle.
Yes.
Your dream will be unfulfilled. God must be in the plan. Call a meeting with God. God, I want to meet with you this morning because I think I heard from you last night. Did you really say that I should do this or that? Then God, I'm going to put out my fleece like Gideon.
Yes.
I'm going to put out my fleece like Gideon. And, yes. And if this be you, God,
yes.
Let me see the reality with minimum effort on my part to fulfill this dream. And I will give you all the glory. All of the glory. All of it is yours, Lord. Because I can only do all things through Christ who strengthens me. It is not by my power or by my might, but it is by the Spirit. The thing is that a lot of people are making sure they are in the Times newspaper. Amen. They are in the Times newspaper, or some politician, or the president might give them a medal, and they forget that Jesus says that you are to store these things up in heaven. Where rust and moth do not decay, and thieves do not break in and steal.
Amen.
Secondly, Joseph had a God-given dream. In verses 5 and 9, it says, "And Joseph dreamed a dream, and he told it to his brethren, and they hated him." Verse 9 says, "And he dreamed yet another dream and told it to his brethren." The two dreams confirmed that the dream came from God.
Yes.
And they were guaranteed by God's promise. They were guaranteed by God's promise. Two dreams are significant. When God speaks twice, it becomes more significant. Look at chapter 41, verse 32 with me. And let us see that that is scriptural. When God speaks twice, it means that God is going to see it through.
Amen.
Chapter 41, verse 32 says, "And for that the dream was doubled unto Pharaoh twice, it is because the thing is established by God, and God will shortly bring it to pass." Amen. So when that thought is reoccurring, and you know that you're hearing God's voice, it means that God will shortly bring it to pass.
Amen.
The problem of self-contrived dream Ecclesiastes chapter 5, verse 7 says, "For in the multitude of dreams and many words, there are also diverse vanities, but fear thou God." Fear thou God. Do not let your dreams detract you from where you're going with God. Because your aspirations have a way of letting you forget God. You know, that's why a lot of people are not in church this morning, because of their aspirations. They have to work today. They have to work 8 days a week so that they can accomplish their aspirations, which the Bible calls vanity, so that they may heap things upon themselves. Therefore, they forget their priority. Their priority is God. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. All these things shall be added unto you. Much dreaming and many words are meaningless. Therefore, stand in awe of God. Stand in awe of God. Have you heard some people brag? They brag about everything. "Well, you know, I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that." And it makes them sound great, you know what I'm saying? It makes them sound so overly ambitious. "I'm going to achieve this, and I'm going to achieve that. Yeah, man, and I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do that." And it makes them sound like one of those great positive thinkers that you watch on TV. The only problem with the positive thinker on TV is that he's not making it without those who do not think positively. They're the ones who buy the books. Guy come out on TV and say, "I can tell you how to make millions. Just buy this book." In 4 weeks, he's a billionaire. He's flying a Learjet. He's getting speaking opportunities. He's charging $10,000 an hour to tell you what's written in his book. All you get out of it is the book at the end of the day. Self-contrived dreams are self-serving. Self-contrived dreams are self-serving. Joseph did not make up his dreams. That's why his brothers took his dream seriously. They could have said, "Oh man, that was a great nightmare. The mare should have eaten some of their sheaves that you had there. That was a big nightmare." But they took it seriously, because somewhere along the way, his brothers knew that he loved the Lord. Somewhere along the way, they knew that he was not like them, that he was not as misbehaving as they were. He was the one who was carrying the report of their bad behavior. He was the Mr. Goody Two-Shoe. And whenever you're trying to live right, your brethren are not going to love you. Your brethren are not going to love you.
Amen.
And they will sell you out in a New York minute. I'm telling you. I've had pastors tell me, "Oh, You are too heavily righteous to be any earthly good. And I have to respond to them, unless I am heavily righteous, I am no earthly good. Because my focus is on the Lord. So your brethren are not going to like you if you start to walk right with God. They're going to shun you.
Yes. Shut the door.
They're going to scandalize you.
Yes.
They're going to leave you.
Yes, it's true.
They're going to lie on you.
Yes, yes, yes.
They're going to say every evil thing they can against you.
Yes.
They're going to plot against you.
Yes.
They're going to get on the phone and they are going to talk about you. If you want to make a great sacrifice of your friends and company and your brethren, start walking right. You know you don't have to get rid of your friends when you start walking right.
They get rid of you.
Trust me. They get rid of you so fast.
Yes, it's true.
You don't have to worry about you getting rid of them. They will get rid of you. They will cast you in the pit.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
They will cast you in the pit.
Yes, yes. So correct. Jesus of Nazareth. Oh, God. Jesus, Jesus.
They will. When you trust in God, God will give you vision. And those visions are going to separate you from a lot of people. Joseph did not make up his dream. Such action would have demonstrated a height of arrogance. God does not promise to bless our dreams. Mark this now. God does not promise to bless our dreams. He promises to bless the dreams he imparts to us as we learn to walk in those dreams. So your dreams that you're concocting on your own, God will never bless those dreams. But he will bless the dreams he inspired in your life as you learn to walk in those dreams. Your dreams that you concoct wants to lead you on a highway. It's going to take you on a highway of success. You're going to be on television. You're going to be on Donald Trump's show. You're going to make it. That's the dream you're concocting. But the dream that God is going to take you through, you may have to go in a pit. People are going to dislike you when you're walking in God's dream. They're not going to like you. But remember this, they are not the ones who bless you.
That's correct. So true.
It's God who blesses
Amen.
You.
Amen. My God, Jesus.
So how do you have a God dream for your life? Look at your talents and your gifts that God has given you. one of us has a gift. One gift or another. Take a look at those gifts and look at those gifts intently and form a dream for your life based on what God has given you. You see, you're not a realtor. So you're not going to make it as a realtor, even though you see them on television telling you to invest in their program. And you'll be rich overnight. The problem with us is that we're always looking at somebody else's gift and somebody else's talent, and we want to be like somebody else instead of being the person God wants us to be. God has imparted gifts to us. Open to God leading you into an area of ministry and service. No matter how humble it may seem, God has both gifts and calling. For the gift, Romans chapter 11, verse 29 says, for the gifts and calling are of God. For the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. What does that mean? It means the gift that you have, you had it before you became a Christian. It was not manifested without the power of the Holy Spirit. Do you hear me now?
Amen.
The gift that you had was not given to you since you became a Christian. You had that gift, Paul says, before salvation.
Yes. Amen.
But it is not manifested without the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
So you are to ask God, really go to him and say, God, what would you have me to do? What would you have me to do? I do this well. I sing well. I think I'm gifted in the area of praise and worship. I would make a great Levite. Hallelujah. You know, I think I'm good at being an usher of welcoming someone into your house. I am good at a one-to-one evangelism where I can meet someone on the street and my spirit can reach out to them and I can talk to them and bring them into the kingdom. These are my gifts, God. Whatever my gift is, God, my gift is cleaning. Sometimes I ask the Lord, Lord, have you sentenced me to cleaning? I go to church, I clean. I stay at home, I clean. I can't get rid of cleaning. Because I love a clean surrounding. Whatever your gift is, ask God. You know, when I was a little boy at 8 years old, and I came to the Lord at the age of eight, by the age of 11, I was teaching Sunday school. I was substituting for Sunday school teachers. At the age of 12, I taught the young men's class, Daniel's band. These were men who were 18, going up in their 20s. I would kneel on the pew in front of them and teach them God's word. I would conduct school devotions. Because at age 8, I knew God had called me to preach. I tried to run away from it when I was 14 years of age. I said, God, just give me one night. I am too innocent. give me one night of sin. He gave me 5 years. He led me through the wilderness for 5 years. He says, one night to you is one night. But 1,000 years in my sight is as an evening pass. It was the longest night of my life. And when I came back to the Lord, I was talking yesterday to a sister, and I said, when I came back to the Lord, he brought me back running with the word, running with the word. I mean, 1 week after I came back to the Lord, I had one of the greatest open air service because I preached to the people in the bar where I used to drink. They wouldn't come out to listen to me, and I'd go to the door. And I had a captive audience. Preach the word of God to them. What do you want to do for God? What is your gift? What has God called you to do? Don't sit around with the gift. Ask God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, to fill you up with the dunamis spirit, the dunamis power, the dynamite power, the power that evokes change, so that whatever you do, it will touch someone's heart. Sometimes you don't know how simple you do things and people come to the Lord. You don't even realize that you said a passing word that encouraged someone's heart, and that person stood right where you left them and gave their heart to the Lord. Many, many years after, you will hear, oh, you led me to the Lord. When did I do such a thing? You passed me at the bus stop and you said some words, and I thought about them and I asked God to forgive me. Think about your God-given dream. Take your focus on contrived dreams and ambitions. They will lead you nowhere. God's signature must be on it. Have a meeting with God, and he will direct your path. Thirdly, Joseph knew how to make his dreams become reality. Joseph knew how to make his dreams become reality. For your dreams to become reality, it takes faith and patience. For you to turn those dreams into reality, it might not happen overnight. It takes faith and it takes patience. Hebrews chapter 6 verse 12 says, that ye be not slothful, but followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promise. You cannot be like the sloth. Wants to hang upside down on the tree all day. You have to move forward with patience and with faith. Nobody can see what you see in your own life. What God has for you, he might not have shown it to anybody else. Sometimes we're looking to other people for the answer. But God has shown you where he wants to take you. Focus on what God has shown you. Because other people will take you off course. Focus on what God has shown you. You know, I thought of something one night, and like crazy. I was at this function and I just blurted it out. I just blurted it out. Within 1 week, one of the guys who was standing right next to me incorporated a company and started to do exactly what I blurted out. I couldn't fight him. All I could do was say, Lord, maybe I should not have said anything. And then I said, maybe that was him. Maybe he should have done it and I was only a messenger. But you can't always, you got to talk to God good first before you talk to anybody else.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen?
Amen? You talk to God good first. Patent it in heaven and nobody can take it from you.
Amen, amen, amen.
Patent it in heaven and nobody can take it from you. It took tremendous faith for Joseph to share his dream with his family. It took a lot of faith. He was only 17. He knew the possibility of being misunderstood. But he believed deeply in what God had shown him. You have to keep faith in the face of misunderstanding. People are going to misunderstand you. But you have to keep your faith. Not everybody can understand when God has given you a dream, a vision. Believe in your dream. When no one else understands or supports you, believe in what God has called you to do.
Amen. 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 Amen.
Even Jesus' own family thought he had lost his mind.
Yes.
They thought he had lost his mind. What is he talking about? We have the same mother and the same father. What is he talking about? They misunderstood him. It was not until after his resurrection that his brothers believed in him. They gave him no support. It was not until that grave was open on Sunday morning and Jesus walked out of there that they said, oh, oh, wow, he was really telling the truth. James and John were so alarmed. Let me tell you something. Follow the dream God has given you. Take the vision that God has given you and run with it. Sometimes you don't understand where God wants to take you. You yourself don't understand it. You have this vision and you don't understand where God wants to take you. You see the vision, and all of a sudden you start to plan it one way. Because this is how you would like it to work. You know, when God gave me the vision for global evangelistic ministry, I was never ever thinking of a church. I went to my pastor and I said, God has given me a vision. As a matter of fact, he was sitting at my desk. And I said, God has given me a vision. As I started to put this together, July 16, 1999. It was about 1 p.m. And I just started typing. I just started typing and making up the globe taking a binder and I started a plan of action. Not knowing where God wants to take me. Because I was going to go to Egypt and Africa. And I was going to travel the world and preach the gospel. I even tell somebody, when we finally get the Learjet for Global, one of them joked and said, I hope you won't be flying. That wasn't part of my vision. But I was dreaming big. I didn't know it was going to start as a meeting place in our sister's living room. Till it moved to another place where we became a little bit uncomfortable. Till God provided another place for us where we have settled in temporarily again on the journey to where he wants to take us as a church, as a part of the body of Christ. I didn't understand it. I couldn't understand it. But God wants you to follow his direction. Lao Tzu was a crippled Chinese woman who opened a home for cripples in China on the site of a pond where crippled children were once thrown to their deaths. In that small room, her faith worked through her love to save children. She inspired others and as a result received finances by which she was able to help those in desperate need. Think of it. A cripple setting up a home for cripples. She said, my religion is to think the unthinkable thought, to speak the ineffable word, to do the impossible deed, and to walk the impossible way. At her funeral, she was described as one who possessed the miracle of a healthy mind and an illumined face. She had a dream from God and it became a reality because of the promise of God. God made a promise to Abraham. God carried that promise through according to Deacon Stephen in Acts chapter 7. God carried this through. That's one of the greatest sermons ever written. Acts chapter 7. Deacon Stephen was a brilliant man of God. He had no notes. They were just about to stone him to death. And as the king asked him if it is true, as the high priest said to him, is it true that you're stirring up trouble in the name of Jesus? He started to tell them all the way from Genesis, all the way down, the promise of Abraham that was fulfilled through Jacob, through Joseph, the dreamer. And the promise of God. Patience is important. This means to be long-suffering, to be undismayed by difficulties and difficult people. It means that nobody can shift you from your focus. Because you know that God has pointed you this way. And nobody is going to take you off course. Might not sound intelligent to some people. It might not look promising to some people. It might not look possible to some people. Oh, it might not look at all as if this can ever come to anything. But God has brought you on that course. The success might not come in your time. Abraham did not see the promised land. Not in his time. But he said, I look for a land whose foundation and builder is God. But he got the vision. Somebody else may steer the ship to shore, but it was you that God gave the vision, and you gave it your best. I like the words of Mother Teresa. She was up there with the cast out of society. Those who were sick with leprosy. A missionary went up to visit with her. And the missionary said, Mother Teresa, you're wasting your time. What good can you do for these people? They're not getting better. She looked at him and she said, God did not call me to be successful. He told me to be faithful.
Jesus, Jesus, be faithful. Jesus.
It's not going to become one of the great success stories, but if I am faithful, that's what matters. Hallelujah. 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 Be patient. Be faithful. Difficulties are going to come your way. And you're going to see God at work in your most adverse circumstances. Joseph saw God at work as in his most adverse circumstances. His brothers began to apologize to him for selling him out.
Jesus.
His brothers bowed before him and said, we're sorry. We are sorry.
Jesus.
Joseph, we're sorry. Forgive us. Joseph said, get up off your knees. But as for you, ye thought evil against me. But God meant it unto good.
Yes.
To bring to pass as it this day, as it is this day, to save much people alive.
Amen.
Now fear ye not.
Amen.
Now fear ye not.
Jesus.
Because what the devil meant for evil,
Lord,
God meant it for good. It was the road to the reality of the vision.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Through many dangers,
Jesus,
toils and snares,
Jesus,
I have already
Jesus
come.
Jesus.
Joseph's dream would be fulfilled.
Jesus.
Perseverance is required because all dreamers must be tested.
Amen.
He spent 13 years in prison before his dream reached fulfillment. God's purpose in patience is to bring us into a greater conformity to the image of Christ so that he might get the glory. Perseverance must finish its work so that you might grow up, that you might become mature and complete, not lacking anything. James chapter 1 verse 4 says, but let patience have her perfect work, that he may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. God wants to lead you today. Whether you're dreaming when you're young or you're old, recognize your God-given dream and know God will show you how to make your dream a reality. God will show you how to make your dream a reality. How about it with you today? Have you given up on your dream? Don't give up. Be patient. Be patient. God is not finished with you yet. You are a work in progress. I was driving home one night, and I'm closing with this. And as I bent the curve to go right into my parking space, I was driving a big old van I had, and I was driving, and I was really tired, and I had to preach something, and I was really tired, and I'm saying, God, how can I prepare to preach after this work? Why do I have to work so hard? And as audible as ever, I knew God was a passenger in that van. He said to me, I'm building your character. To tell my wife these things, because if I don't tell her these things, I won't have a witness. He said, I'm building your character. I called a brother a couple days after that, and I was talking to him. And without saying anything to him, I was telling him of my travails and my trials. And he says, brother, God is building your character. Be patient. God is working on your character. Be patient. God bless you. As you take the vision and you run with it, knowing that with God, it will become a reality.
This little saying in my phone I look at from time to time. It says, failure is often temporary, but giving up makes it permanent. You know, God gives you something for you. In the world, you know, yeah, they're going to say a lot of things, but be patient, because God is faithful. He really is. He really is. Praise the Lord. The invitational hymn in your hymnal, number 588.
Number 588, Keyshawn. Invitational Hymn 588.
Thank you.
You need the faith. You need the courage to go with the vision. It took great courage for Joseph to go to his brothers and to tell them such a dream that he knew in his spirit would upset them. But he says, "This is what the Lord says." He didn't fix it up. He just told them what the Lord showed him. And they got mad. But them being mad was part of the vision. Them being mad was part of the vision. It could never have been fulfilled without them being mad. What a wonderful God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. Bow your heads and close your eyes. Eternal God and our Heavenly Father, we love you and we adore you. We thank you for the mighty, powerful God you are.
Thank you, Lord.
We thank you, Lord God, for our dreams and our visions.
Hallelujah.
We thank you that they do not always happen the way we would like them to happen. But God, as we hold on to your unchanging hand, you will lead us, Lord God, to the reality of our visions. God, we ask you now that for everyone within the sound of my voice here in this sanctuary and outside of this sanctuary, that God, they may rise with their vision and they may go forward. Because God, we listen to one voice and one voice only, your voice. So God, we go with what you want to, you want us to do, what you have told us to do, and we will not be afraid. Because God, no one can stand in our way when you want to take us to our destiny. Bless everyone here today. Give them the patience and the faith and the courage to go with you and to walk with you and to continue to talk to you and to continue, Lord God, to pursue that vision which you have given them, knowing that they are doing your will and it will not come to naught. We bless your name now. Take us home to our individual places of abode so that, God, we may continue to worship you and give you the glory. And bless us all as we leave our cares in your hand, saying thanks in Jesus' name. And everyone say, amen. Our closing hymn is We Shall Overcome. It's in your bulletins. It's in your bulletins. The great civil rights movement song done by Mahalia Jackson during this civil rights movement, We Shall Overcome.
Today, oh. The truth shall make us free. The truth shall make us free. Someday. I do believe the truth shall make us free someday. We shall live in peace. We shall live in peace. We shall live in peace someday.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you. And the Lord give you peace, both now, henceforth, and forevermore. God bless you.